National Affairs. So she's actually going to be leading this afternoon at 3 p.m., the Senate concurrence. So we're looking forward to that. But one thing that we really worked on dito sa, from the among the climate change advocates is that we're pushing for this a more ambitious goal pagdating po sa increase po ng temperatura, which is kami po, ang Pilipinas po, and I think we should all be proud of our Philippine delegation. Tayo po ay nag-push po ng 1.5 degrees Celsius goal. Hindi ko lang po alam kung to what extent you're very familiar with this 1.5 degrees Celsius goal. It is coming out a lot in the news. Pero this will allow us to basically save, the Philippines from the dire impacts of climate change. Tayo po ay like fifth most vulnerable country when it comes to climate change all over the world. So, kung ngayon pa lang, ngayon nasa 1.2 degrees Celsius po tayo ay dati pa, nagka-Yolanda na tayo, nagka-Ondoy, and these are all at 1 degree Celsius. So, napaka-importante po ito for the Philippines. And I hope that with you, as members of the press also, that you can help bring out this message about yung the importance of our being here and the importance of us leading the way when it comes to yung pagdating po sa mga climate change objectives. Of course, ang kasama din dito at ito yung mga palaging this is one of the discussions we're talking about is once naging members po tayo ng Paris Agreement and become a party, ay meron na magkaka-access po tayo sa financial support, sa teknolohiya, sa capacity building. Ang Paris Agreement po ay may goal po sila na we'll have about $100 billion per year. So, starting 2020. So, pagkasama po tayo sa Paris Agreement, ay makakamas-access tayo dito sa mga financial support na available for us, lalo na as a developing country. I think ito nga yung one of the things na palagi natin ipinaglalaban is that as a developing country, tayo po ay maliit lang po yung ating contribution sa mga emissions. We're one-third of 1% of emissions. Yet, tayo ay isa sa mga pinaka-vulnerable na countries pagdating sa climate change. So, ito po ay kasama po sa Paris Agreement. Itong sabi nilang common but differentiated responsibilities. It's a principle po, pero it's basically saying that developed countries will take also more responsibility compared to developing countries pag sa pag-address po ng climate change. So that's yun po yung makukuha natin as part of the Paris Agreement. But syempre, we're now party to this big global deal, no? So ang ating obligation lang po under this is that we will have a tawag nila technical po. So pero tawag po nila is nationally determined contribution. Pero ito po ay paano tayo lahat makatulong to achieve yung 1.5 degrees Celsius na goal, yung 2 degrees Celsius na goal. Well, pero tayo kasi as vulnerable, talagang pinupush natin, let's go for the 1.5. Kasi hindi aabot. Pag lumampas po tayo ng 1.5, yung mga coral reefs po natin, magsasuffer. Ang crops po natin, 98% po of coral reefs will be at risk. Pagdating po ng 2 degrees Celsius din, yung ating mga crops, mahihirapan na po for adaptation purposes. Hindi na po tayo makakatanim as much. Right now, last year, 1.2 degrees Celsius na po tayo. So this is something we're continuously advocating at kailangan po natin i-lead ang ating mga iba't ibang bansa. Kasi hindi po natin ito kakayanin na mag-isa eh. Kasi yun nga lang po, maliit lang po yung contribution natin sa climate change. So ito na nga lang. So, pagkatapos doon, so anong gagawin natin as a country? Ito po ay pinag-usapan namin. Ano nga ba ang sasubmit po namin to before 2020? Kung ano nga ba ang contribution natin to climate change para sa goal na to? Ang plano po natin is that we want to make sure na naka-incorporate po dito ang mga goals ni Presidente also of really poverty eradication, mga sustainable development. So, pwede po to under the Paris Agreement. So, yung pag-adaptation, itong ang ibig sabihin nito is how we're going to adjust assuming yung pag-increase po ng temperature. So, yun rin ipo-focus namin as well as yung mitigation at reduction ng emissions. Pero lahat po ito nasa konteksto ng ano yung ating, you know, with all of our sustainable development because the president has also been, and this administration is very keen on eradicating poverty here. So, Aside from that, I know we have a lot of briefers on this. Meron yata kayong kit na pinadala dyan, so you can ask us questions. But I think I'd like to also make a quick announcement. Kasi while we have the international, agreement, ang pinaka-critical, what's most critical for us right now is yung ang nang gagawin natin locally. Kasi ito po, nasa control po natin. So we're also very pleased to announce in the commission that yesterday we had a meeting with the League of Municipalities of the Philippines. So there's about mga, the League of Municipalities po, mga 1,500 mayors po yun. But we had about, I think there's about slightly less than that, pero maganda po yung attendance eh. Pero we were able to ask them to sign certificates, commitment certificates to do their local climate change action plans. So ito po ay ipapresent po namin sa president mamayang hapon. But for us, this was such a very big win. Mga 1,700 lang po ang ating local government units. So we have like a majority of local government units committing na yung climate change na realidad na po dito ng Pilipinas ay pwede na nila ipasok sa mga plano. Actually, na incorporate na po ito sa, this is already mandated by law, so we're giving this a bigger push this year with the Climate Change Commission. Talaga lahat ng local action, I think those are just photos from yesterday's event. Pero ito po yung, this is another proud thing that we're proud that we are announcing as a commission, and we hope, actually we'd like to appeal to everyone here sa press, no, to help bring out this word about, you know, the need for to handle both the international discussions, but at the same time, ang local po, kahit anong gawin po namin sa internationally, pag yung local, hindi po yan, pag yung bahay o eskwelahan ay hindi nandun pa rin sa area na binabaha o lina-landslide, mamamatay pa rin yung tao. So, kailangan po lahat ng mga siyensya na alam namin sa climate change ay maintindihan po ng mga local administrators at talaga para we can start saving lives at maayos rin po yung mga livelihood ng mga tao at isipin po nila yung bagyo, magkakaroon po ng droughts, magkakaroon po ng yung fish production po ay bababa as the temperature of this world increases. So with that, I'd like to close a little bit of this announcement, but kung meron po kayong mga tanong, feel free to ask, and you know, we hope also for a stronger you know, cooperation with you and the commission. Salamat po. Maraming salamat.
Thank you, Commissioner Vernice. The floor is now open for question. First question from Raymond Tenaza of Bombo Radio. Microphone, please.
Good morning, ma'am.
Good morning,
ma'am. Yes. Can you update us if you have any monitoring to what countries have so far, those who signed the agreement, have passed or ratified in their own congresses that Paris Agreement? Baka naman tayo naman yung masyadong excited kasi.
We have about, actually medyo huli na po tayo. Mga 134 countries na po ang nag-ratify. So, tayo nasa 130. O, pang nasa ano na tayo talaga. Kasi hindi pa tayo nag-concur eh, yung Senate. So, talagang, total of parties natin is about 197.
And US and China already ratified?
Yes.
US?
US, yes. Okay. Bago pa, si Obama pa, by an executive. Yeah, meron silang ginawa. Yes.
Executive, by executive order, but not by Congress.
It's executive agreement. Executive agreement. I'm just checking lang with my lawyers kung tama yung ano, yung
term ko. But not yet under Congress, kasi baka...
Ano na yun eh, considered na sila ratified eh. In terms of like the I'll have to ask the exact, you know, but what they basically did is they changed the way they will actually ratify this agreement. So they didn't do it by an act of Congress. I know Obama did something to that extent.
Also, ma'am, it's not about emission, but on the vulnerability. Sure. So, but I understand the most vulnerable communities are those situated along with those illegal logging and irresponsible mining. So do you fully support the advocacies of Secretary Gina Lopez?
Of course, we support her. I mean, as an environmentalist with her, she's been such a passionate advocate for the environment. And the logging, when it comes to logging, at the very, ayun talaga pagdating sa greenhouse gas emissions, alam niyo po, meron actual study na ang mga forests po natin, they reduce about 80% of our emissions. Tapos ang mga, that's in 2010, no? So ang laki po ng kontribusyon ng forestry. Ang mga mangroves at bamboo, yun isa sa mga pinaka sinusuportahan yung mga proyekto for climate change. That also helps sa storm surges at dating sa bamboos kasi nakakatanggal po yun ng emission sa atmosphere. So talagang, she's a very strong and pure, passionate environmental advocate.
And you support her move and even the announcement of the president last night for a total ban on mining.
Pagdating po sa mining, hindi po talaga yung climate change issue per se. So I'd like to, if it's okay, I'll talk about the logging and the forestry. But with the mining, we support this administration. But I'm afraid that's not really within our purview as the Climate Change Commission.
Yeah, but because of the stronger catastrophes, typhoods, and directly hit the most.
But the thing, but definitely, I will still say though that it's important to protect ang mga watersheds, especially when we have going to have a water security issue pagdating po sa climate change. But I will, I'll just have to leave it to Secretary Lopez and of course the President when it comes to the mining issue. But we are there coordinating with them. Sure.
Yeah, going back to the vulnerability, because we are speaking of billion or million of dollars that we can get from after signing the Paris Agreement.
Okay.
So can we expect to share a sum for those to be affected by the possible closure of mining operations? I understand they are the most, and they should deserve at least support because they are the most vulnerable with the typhoons and flooding.
Sige, titingnan. Pero siguro, yes, because sa mining, if we can position po our funding proposal that this is for climate change adaptation, pwede naman po because the Green Climate Fund allows us to have funding for both mitigation, the reduction of emissions, at the adaptation. So, yun lang po yung dapat very clear na this is the objective. It allows us to reach the climate change adaptation goals.
Thank you, ma'am.
Thank you. Salamat din.
All right. Next question, Joseph Morong of GMA7.
Ma'am, good morning. Yung pong 100 billion na green fund, no?
Sure.
Paano yung pooling nun from countries? And then, you mentioned in passing yung pag-access nun in terms of programs, no? A climate adaptation. 2 points. How do you pool it? And then, how do we access it as a nation?
All of the developed countries like have their own contributions. They're supposed to, kasi itong nationally determined contributions, it's medyo may pagka-voluntary eh. So, iba't iba ang mga contribution ng bawat bansa. But this is really mostly from developed countries. Right now, we're still trying to hit the $100 billion. Anyway, 2020 pa naman yun, no? So there's still a lot of negotiations ongoing on how to make sure the developed countries hit this $100 billion. So for the past 4 years, we're still... And that they report on kung magkano talaga ang na-contribute nila dito sa $100 billion. So it's still a tricky process, I'll say, for the... And hopefully we'll get there. Access-wise, meron pong mga... There's a Green Climate Fund, no? So we'll have to develop project proposals. This has to be cleared through the nationally designated authority, and then tapos. So it goes through an exact process. Actually, one thing na pinag-usapan nga namin is we really have to actively dito sa Pilipinas create this project proposals. Tayo nga sa isa sa mga pinaka malakas na voices pagdating dito sa negotiations ng finance. So tumulong po tayo sa pag-establish nitong Green Climate Fund. Ang si Congressman Salceda actually served as co-chair of this Green Climate Fund. So we were really a strong voice. Pero ang ano natin dito sa local, kaya pinag-usapan din namin sa mga mayors. Mayors kahapon is really how do we push for really accessing, but we'll have to integrate talaga itong mga local programs para kasi medyo may minimum of about $100 million per project, so medyo malaki-laki siya, hindi pwedeng maliit lang yung ating in-applyan.
Just one last point, can we highlight yung effect ng 1.5? You mentioned some of it, na parang 98% of our corals are going to be affected and then our crops. Can you just elaborate on that point? Yeah. Para lang ma intindihan, why should we care about the Paris Agreement?
Yeah, because at one point, well, the 2 degrees Celsius, there was a study, that's 2 degrees Celsius na. The Paris Agreement, technically, I'll say technically, ha, it said there that we want to limit global average temperatures to well below 2 degrees Celsius. Tapos, but to pursue further efforts to limit this to 1.5 degrees Celsius. Ngayon, ang Pilipinas really helped with that 1.5. And as a vulnerable country, we're pushing for that. Kasi at 2 degrees Celsius, wala pa tayong masyadong studies on 1.5. We're gonna come up by next year, I think, on the, yeah, next year on the what 1.5 means. But ang UN po, nag-study na po on the 2 degrees Celsius. And at 2 degrees Celsius, ang lumabas po sa mga studies is that, number one, is that our crops will only have some potential po for adaptation. So, ibig sabihin, baka pag hindi na tayo makakatanim na basta-basta lang, we were not gonna just be able to. So this will affect and threaten really our food security. It can cause some violence. You know what happened sa Kidapawan last year. So that's what we're worried about. Pero a certain study also said that, 2 degrees Celsius is that we will lose about 98% of our coral reefs are at risk. Ngayon pa lang nagbe-bleach na po siya. So, once 98% of our coral reefs, which is the home of the small fishes, baka wala na tayong makakain din in terms of that. Madami pang mga studies ang kakailanganin. There's also indications that at 2 degrees, mga 20% na lang, we'll have 20% less water that's available for us.
Next question, Maricel Halili of TV5.
Sir, ma'am, just a clarification about the financial support. What's the assurance that the developed countries will give the financial support? I understand the target will be in 2020, pero ano yung assurance na magbibigay sila? And if they don't give financial assistance, can we help them
responsible? I think,
yes.
Yeah, that's I think that's also a main contention that we have, no? It's we don't have a strong compliance mechanism. It's really a name and shame game here. That's why we're focusing on transparency, that they tell us what they're really giving. At least isang concern pa nga namin dito, anong ire-report nila na finance? Ito ba ay, di ba paminsan, kasi iba't iba to eh, pwede tong grants, pwede tong loans, pwede to via, madami, kasama na siya without part of the bilateral agreement. So these are things that bine-negotiate pa ng what we can do. But the Paris Agreement, yes, doesn't offer punitive measures. Pero there are things in ways that we can, because of the transparency, malalaman kung sinong nag-contribute o hindi nag-contribute. May konting, pwede yung name and shame ang lalabas dun sa Paris Agreement. Pero don't, ang ano ko lang din is that the Paris Agreement, it's the best thing we have at the moment. Meron po tayong, we realize that meron, it can be stronger, perhaps, but we also want to say, ang tagal po ng negotiations, ito po ang, this is what we came up with, and this is the only thing we have. Ang Kyoto Protocol po, yung commitment period, ano na po yun, hindi po, nag-expire na po yun, so that's not, nothing is, we're not able to implement anything right now under the Kyoto Protocol. So the Paris Agreement is what we have, and it's, we're going to just work with it, and we're glad we're part of it, and we'll just try to keep on advocating. Kaya important po na nandun po tayo sa negotiation, so we can continue to fight for a serious, like, stronger compliance, you know, we can start, you know, really still asking for the developed countries to be more transparent in their support at to let us know anong klaseng support ang meron sila. Talagang makita natin they're able to fulfill their obligations.
Ma'am, one last point. Our target is to have 1.5 degrees Celsius. That's our goal, right? And so as the other countries, they also have their own goals. What will happen kung hindi na meet itong mga goals na yun? Meron din ba silang accountability or wala rin tayong binding?
Oo nga eh. Hanggang ngayon pa, we're really calling for higher ambition. Yung goals kasi natin, actually we submit commitments like every 5-year period. So, I will admit na meron ngang studies sa mga indicated contributions nila is that hindi pa po umaabot pa tayo hanggang 3 degrees Celsius. Considering na po may commitments. Kasi ganito po yun, yung kung assuming business as usual at wala po tayong gawin, aabot po tayo ng mga 4 to 5 degrees Celsius. Tapos in-account ng mga scientists kung magkano ang, I mean, how much reductions ang ma-achieve ng Paris Agreement, lumabas po sa report nito is 3 degrees Celsius pa po at the end of the century. So this is not enough. We are still really continuously still fighting for this because, ayun, we have to be able to reach the 1.5 and the 2. So it's medyo tricky po yung medyo tricky po yung process also inside, no, how we're going to really push for this. But definitely if we can encourage the members of the press to so that we can really rally people behind this pushing for this higher, this 1.5 C, because the Philippines masasalanta po siya talaga.
Thank you. Any more question? Last question, Ace Romero from Philippine Star.
Commissioner, local governments, yes, are required to come up with their climate plans, right? They are required to come up with their,
yes,
own. Okay. Ilan na po yung meron na at ilan yung wala pa?
We have various numbers. We have an official number of about 1,000, well, 300, umiiba ha ang numbers namin. So we have 300 and then a 600. Pero meron din naka-report dun sa LG, sa DILG, which is about 1,115. Pero they call it first, hindi pa to na quality assure, so it's, they call it a document. To Colatilia is a document called LCCAP. So we have to look at it. But hopefully with yesterday, we're saying, can we do the LCCAP in the proper format? At talagang, kasi hindi po namin talaga nakikita kung ano po nang dun sa LCCAP na yun eh. So I wish I could give you a stronger number or a better number. The official number you've received from with the DILG is 1,115. Kasi we're doing this in partnership with DILG.
Ano yun? Majority ba yun? Or?
Majority na yun. Kung assume po natin na talagang LCCAP po yun ha. Kasi we have a total of 1,700 LGUs sa Philippines.
So out of the 1,700, ilan yung may submission?
1,115 out of over 1,700. Pero that's one thing. Pero ang sinasabi po ng iba is just 300 or 600 talaga ang tama yung quality.
Kaya, so the rest?
The rest. Ang hirap po magsalita eh. Sa ganun, pero I'm just telling you lang what the information is.
Pero are we saying wala silang plans at all? Parang ganun?
Hopefully after today magkakaroon, and we are really gonna push it na magkakaroon na po sila ng mga plans.
Pero wala. As it stands, wala.
Walang plans ang mga LG.
Wala silang sinubmit na...
Yung 1,115, meron pong sinabit. Tinawag po nila LCCAP.
Eh, hindi po namin... Yung iba? Wala.
Baka hindi po... nag-report. Hindi po natin alam.
So, ano yung implication nun? Anong implication nun kung hindi sila nag-submit?
Well, alam ko, for them, wala silang seal of good governance. Pero in our case, kami, hindi po nila na-incorporate, hindi po nila... na process kung anong vulnerability nila sa climate change. Kasi ang importante dun is tingnan po namin yung mga hazards, anong exposure nila sa climate change. Tapos ipapasok po nila yun sa plano, anong mga actions ang pwede nilang gawin. So, kailangan medyo future planning po ito. Tapos ma-incorporate rin po ito sa land use plan at sa CDP nila, sa
so
development
overall
plan.
Ano yung risk na they fail to submit? Ano yung magiging possible impact nito dun sa mga constituents nila, sa mga taong nasa...
Sana nga constituents talaga natin, we have to actually really ask our mayors to push for this local climate change action plan. Kasi at the very least, kunyari yung land use plan, alam ko that, you know, we're still building on areas na alam natin ay mababaha, malalandslide. So, dapat, I think, we as common, the people have to start demanding and asking our local governments, please, tingnan nyo na ba ito? Anong impact sa amin? So, that's also for our safety precaution. Meron na pong mga science, meron na pong mga maps available. So, kailangan lang po ito makuha po ng mga local government units, i-absorb, i-integrate po sa kanilang mga plano.
So, yung CCC can only persuade them to submit? Wala tayong parang...
We're not... Oo nga, kasi we're a coordinating body. DILG is really the... we're working closely with DILG for this development of the LCCAP. So, at hindi po kami implementing body. So, it's, may technical assistance, capacity build. Yeah, so it's capacity building, pagdating po sa mga LGUs.
Thank you, Commissioner.
Thank you.
Okay, just one last question from Trisha Tarado of CNN Philippines.
Hi, ma'am. Can you just please give us an overview of how the Philippines and other countries fared in the past agreements? And kasi nga po, given that we don't have penalties or checks and balance on how to or how to monitor the agreements or that we are getting into, how are we sure that we are not in the losing end here?
How are we not sure that we are not in the losing end when it comes to agreements?
Yes.
Well, we will eventually have a voting right pagdating sa mga agreements. So we have to have a stronger delegation. We've had one of the strongest delegations in, I'll admit na talagang pinapakinggan po ang Pilipinas pagdating po dun sa negotiation. So I think, we should be proud of that. And but the best way that we can really do there is develop the negotiating team. So, hindi lang po ang Climate Change Commission ang pumunta doon, but we have representatives from various parties, of course, the DFA, but then for finance, we have DOF, NEDA, so they're all going there. So, important that we really watch over this. And if we can be part of like the, and of course, the NGOs are part of us, are part of the delegation, no? Pero one thing also is that we can be part of the, yung meron kasi mga committees, meron committees, so that one they develop a bit of the rulebook. Ngayon kasi ginagawa pa yung rulebook ng Paris Agreement. Kung nabasa nyo po yung Paris Agreement, it's still very general. So yung lahat ng implementing rules ay dinidiscuss pa namin hanggang 2020 or maybe even further up there. So we have to be part of that discussion. Kailangan po tayong magsalita, we can vote. Kasi if we say no naman, hindi naman po magkakaroon ng agreement. Eh. So that's, ano, at pero madami pong mga discussions, so we have to be active there at kailangan po maintindihan ng ating mga negotiators kung ano yung issues para they can make sure we put the legal, ano yun eh, di ba? We put the necessary precautions in the final treaty. Rulebook, tapos na yung treaty. Sige.
Alright. Thank you very much, Commissioner Vernice Victorio of the Climate Change Commission.
Thank you.
Okay.
Thank you, Commissioner. On to other items. We'd like to highlight several things that has been both in the news and also initiatives coming from the executive branch. The Philippines is an ideal business environment for women to prosper, according to MasterCard. The Philippines ranks 8th among top 20 markets in the world, gaining an overall index of 68.4, on the MasterCard Index of Women Entrepreneurs in 2017. This means that the Philippines is an enabling and nurturing environment for Filipino women in business entrepreneurship. Women are given career growth opportunity and support in services such as finance, education, and enterprise. The Duterte administration continues to support the endeavors of Filipino women. Philippine merchandise exports surged 22.5%. The palace is pleased to announce that the Philippine merchandise exports reached 5.13 billion in January, surging 22.5%, the highest growth posted in 3 years. Garments and clothing accessories led gainers with a 270% increase, followed by coconut oil products, which grew 230%, chemicals at 105%, among others. Japan is still the top Philippine export destination. Export businesses are included in the 2017 Investment Priorities Plan, IPP, which the President approved recently, and we shall accelerate efforts to attract inward foreign direct investments in areas covered in the IPP to further boost our export of manufacturers. Finally, on the meeting of the Executive Committee of the National Security Council, President Rodrigo Roa Duterte today, 13-14, we ended, right, led the Executive Committee of the National Security Council in addressing a wide range of issues affecting the national security. Discussed were matters concerning the peace process with the CPP, NPA, NDF, the West Philippine Sea issue, and the anti-illegal drugs campaign, among others. During the meeting, the President approved the Enhanced National Security Policy 2017-2022 NSP that serves as guide for the government bureaucracy in the efforts at safeguarding and promoting Philippine national security interests. More importantly, this version of the NSP now directs the national security sector to be aligned with and in tandem with the recently approved Philippine Development Plan. On the peace process, the President acknowledged the joint statement of the GPH and NDF peace panels on the intent to resume formal peace talks. To ensure that genuine peace talks are realized, the President asked both panels to agree on clear parameters for ceasefire and the talks. Regarding the West Philippine Sea issue, the President gave his full support to the improvement of capabilities of law enforcement agencies in monitoring Philippine airspace and territorial waters. Finally, the President reiterated his resolve to address the drug problem within his term. Towards this end, he directed the NICA and NBI to be more actively involved in the PDEA-led anti-drug operations together with the AFP and PNP. For those interested, we'll have copies of the press release.
Okay, the floor is now open for questions. Leila Salaveria of Inquirer.
Yes, ma'am.
Sir, good morning. Sir, there are recent reports of fresh NPA attacks. How will this affect the recently revived peace talks? And what does this say about the sincerity and readiness of the insurgents to talk peace with the government?
I think that's exactly the reason why the President insisted that clear parameters be set so that they themselves are able to work within these parameters, which is clear, because formerly there were no clear parameters.
Sir, did the President say when he wants the unilateral ceasefire of the government to be declared? Because on Sunday, the Defense Secretary said the operations against the NPA would continue until the President himself orders them to implement a unilateral ceasefire.
So you're asking for a timeline?
Yes.
No, they're working it out. With the resumption of the talks, they're working it out.
Yeah. But did he say it has to be before April because the next round of talks would be next month?
There was no specific, as far as I remember, there was no specific time, except that he was quite insistent that clear parameters need to be established.
Okay. Thank you. Hello?
Yes.
Raymond Tenez of Bombo Radio to be followed by Joseph Morong of GMA7.
So just a quick follow-up.
Yes.
So I remember you yourself was firm and very categorical with the compelling reasons before we re-enter into the negotiation with
it was not a precondition, remember? It was not a precondition.
That's what I said, compelling reason.
Right.
That was your term.
Yes.
So
No, your phrase said compelling reasons to enter into a conversation. I said those compelling reasons need to be covered within the conversation.
Yeah, so what now? Have you seen a compelling reason to agree to restart the formal peace talks?
Do I see compelling reasons? No, they're entering into that, and these are things that they need to thresh out.
So it's now clear, you are clarifying that it's not before. But
it was not a precondition.
Yeah, it's within.
Yes.
So, sir, the NDF agreed to declare ceasefire before April 2.
Before they?
April 2.
Yes.
Okay. And isn't it very telling that they will just declare ceasefire just before April 2, and what about this period from now on? So they will be still have windows to do their attacks?
We just have to trust the process, no? However, the President was very insistent, like I said to Ms. Salaveria, that the parameters have to be clear. So, and then having set the parameters, then they should act in a circumspect manner and to act within those parameters.
So, but what is your reading? Their leaders, the National Democratic Front, are already into agreement to restart the formal talks, and yet their men on the ground are continuously attacking our troops.
Well, like I said, let's leave it to their responsibility to be able to deal with their men on the ground. Thank you.
Joseph?
Just a quick follow-up on the NDF issue. Yung pong mga fresh attacks, does it diminish the credibility of the CPP, the CNN, in facing the government? Because di ba dati, pabago-bago, last week lang, galit si Presidente, and then nung weekend, merong Utrecht statement, Parang, well, can he finally trust the CPP now?
Let's put it this way. Between between the parties that are willing to resume talks, they're establishing mutual trust. Okay, and those are the activities on the ground are certainly very they add stress and burden to the talks. However, as far as we can see, there is the intent to pursue the final and lasting peace, which can be brought about by a written agreement.
Any more questions?
Just on WPS, sir. Any mention about the Benham Rise, which is a different subject?
Well, first and foremost, Benham Rise belongs to the Filipino people. And the Philippine government is duty-bound to defend and protect our sovereign and territorial right over this region. Other countries can exercise innocent passage and territorial navigation, but they are disallowed to stay and establish any structure in the area. The Philippines' claim on the region is supported by Article 77 of the United Nations Convention on the Law, or UNCLOS. The Philippines has a responsibility to oversee and regulate the sailing ships of other countries that pass through the waters around Benham Rise.
That's quite a strong statement. Thank you.
Next question from Dexter Ganibe of DZMM.
Hi, Yusek. Good afternoon. Sir, open po ba ang palas tulad nung ginawa dati sa pakikipag-usap sa MLF na mayroong CCCH o yung Committee on the Cessation of Hostilities para ipatupad na siyang magmo-monitor din ng mga hostilities or maiwasan yung mga hostilities sa pagitan ng government troops and NPA habang isinasagawa itong peace talks with the NDF?
Just before I answer that question, let me repeat. Having said that thing about Benham Rise, we will continue to pursue diplomatic talks with the other party. Yes, I'm sorry.
Yes, sir. Meron po bang i-create na isang committee para doon sa pag-monitor sa cessation of hostilities habang
another
group, a third party na magmo-monitor sa galaw ng NPA and the government?
I think let's leave it to them. There's been no proposal regarding the matter.
Pero si Duresa, sir, parang binabanggit niya na are calling the help of the international community
to monitor. Probably so, but it's not yet a fait accompli. It's not yet accomplished. It's not yet a fact. He's still calling, right? He's calling for support. Probably is, and that is an initiative from the OPA.
Ano ba ang palas ay suportado po ba itong panawagan na ito?
Let's see. That since the peace advisor, the office is an extension of the president's personality. Now I suppose yes, we are open to the idea.
Thank you, sir.
Yes, Joseph.
Sir, sa Benham Rise pa rin.
Yes.
What was the president's thoughts about kasi si Secretary Lorenzana mentioned, I think Sunday sa Baguio, na one of the measures that is thinking to protect that property, that territory, is to put up a structure and increase our patrols in that area. I was wondering whether any plans or instructions were given to Secretary Lorenzana towards this answer.
Regarding building any structures, as far as I remember, any resolutions were made, there were none. However, the president did agree that we should improve our capabilities of enforcing our rights in the matter, enforcing our rights regarding airspace and territorial waters.
And how are you going to do that?
Like I said, like the president said, let us strengthen whatever remains.
How do we strengthen that? Do we run to the U.S. or to China to...
No, the logic is we strengthen our own. Okay.
From Russia.
Probably, whatever.
Next question, please. Any more questions? Other topics?
Yes.
Chris Jose of Remate.
Sir, kahapon po sa joint statement, nabanggit po ng Pangulo na may destabilization plot at anong napupuno daw po ay ilang mining firms. Pero ang sabi po ni Secretary Lorenzana, wala pa raw po sila na mamonitor na destab at yung mga criticisms po ay hindi nila maituturing ni ouster scheme. So sir, ang tanong, may destabilization plot po ba talaga sa Pangulo and sa government o wala?
From his perception and what seems to be the conclusions that can be drawn, is that whatever noise there is, both locally and nationally, seems to be instigated by certain parties, and that is the perception of the president. And based on that, you could actually say that there might not be actual action on the ground, but there seems to be some form of propaganda that's going out, that's trying to, destabilize the credibility of the president, the president's administration. Yes.
Okay. Any more questions? None?
No.
All right. Thank you very much. Thank you also, Presidential Spokesperson Ernesto Abella, and to our guest for today, Commissioner Vernice Victorio of the Climate Change Commission. Back to the main studio of PTV4 and Radyo ng Bayan.
Thank you very much. Kayo.